What's up, short attention span history nerds? I'm Mike Perry, and you're watching 10 Minute History. Elizabeth Cochran, or more famously known as Nellie Bly, is the most fascinating woman that I've ever read about. In 1889, she made a famous, widely reported 72-day trip around the globe in a steamship. It was the fastest journey of her era and one that shattered the fictional record of Jules Verne's Phineas Fogg in his novel Around the World in 80 Days. She also went undercover as a journalist in a lunatic asylum. Now, that's what they called nut houses back then, so don't start sending me emails about me being insensitive. To undercover the corruption and horrible conditions that were inside. And she launched what's now referred to as investigative journalism. She became the president of Ironclad Manufacturing Company, which, under Cochran, made and standardized the 55-gallon drum that we still use to this day. In her later years, she covered as a journalist women's suffrage and was arrested for it, and even went overseas to cover World War I on the front lines. But today, we're going to focus on her harrowing times as an undercover journalist patient reporting on the deplorable and illegal conditions in the 19th century insane asylums. Medical historians and patient advocates rightly revere Bly for her infamous expose of the New York City lunatic asylum on Blackwell's Island, now known as Roosevelt Island, in the East River. First reported in October 1887 on the pages of John Pulitzer's flagship newspaper, the New York World, Bly subsequently published her daring adventures as a book, 10 Days in a Madhouse. It's a quick read that remains a classic in the annals of psychiatry and a cogent warning against inhumane treatment of the mentally ill. It proved so embarrassing to the city aldermen that they appropriated an extra $1 million annually to correct many of the abuses Bly exposed. The fascinating question to answer, of course, is how did she do it? But before I answer that, let's go back 7 years to when Bly began her career as a journalist and see what led her to becoming the most fascinating woman in the world. Bly began her journalistic career in 1880 at the young age of 16, writing women's columns on home, cooking, gardening, society, and children rearing for the Pittsburgh Dispatch. Soon enough, she convinced her editor to allow her to investigate taboo topics like how divorce affects women and children to why men who drink often become spousal abusers. Frustrated with being restricted to domestic matters, she spent 6 months in Mexico as a special correspondent reporting on the lives and customs of the Mexican citizens. In one report, she protested the imprisonment of a local journalist for criticizing the Mexican government, then a dictatorship. When Mexican authorities learned of Bly's report, they threatened her with arrest, prompting her to flee the country. Some scholars believe that her expose set a chain of events in motion that culminated in the Mexican Revolution of 1910. Soon after Bly arrived back home, a wire from the Mexican government was sent to the Pittsburgh mayor, who informed Bly that should she ever set foot on Mexican soil again, she would be arrested and imprisoned for trying to start a revolution in Mexico. Only she was alive to see how the media is controlled today in her own country. Anyways, her time in Mexico lit an unquenchable fire. She was determined to root out and uncover matters of oppression, mistreatment of all peoples. Soon after her return from Mexico, she split Pittsburgh, leaving behind a note that simply read, "I'm off for New York. Look out for me." Bly. When she arrived in Manhattan, she set out for the best journalistic newspaper in New York, the New York World. After talking her way into the city room of the New York World, she impressed the editors there enough to leave with a plum assignment. Bly states, "I was asked by the World if I could have myself committed to one of the asylums for the insane in New York, with a view to writing a plain and unvarnished narrative of the treatment of the patients therein. I said, I believed I could. I had some faith in my own ability as an actress and thought I could assume insanity long enough to accomplish my mission. Could I pass a week in the insane ward at Blackwell's Island? I said I could, I would, and I did." Damn, That's a determined woman. Now, getting committed seemed rather easily, as judges back then pronounced women insane at an alarming rate. But neither Bly nor her editor had a way out. Bly asked, "Well, how will you get me out once I'm finished?" Her editor replied, "I don't know. One way or another, we'll get you out." Yeah, I'm not sure that I would hang my freedom on a solid "I don't know." She's got bigger cojones than I do. The following is a quick summation of Nellie Bly's book, 10 Days in a Madhouse. I highly recommend you read this book for yourself, after you've watched my video, of course. Bly set her plan in motion by taking a room at a cheap boarding house. It was the Temporary Home for Females, number 84 Second Avenue. She registered under the name Bly Brown and began her spiral into the insane by questioning and imitating the women who seemed the most insane to her. She smiled very easily at almost every situation. Even her editor pointed out that her constant smiling was going to prove her downfall if she couldn't contain it. As Bly began her masquerade as an insane woman, she began to doubt her own abilities to fool the judge. She felt her act of insanity would appear to be just that, an act. Every time the matron of the boarding house spoke to her, she had to hold a handkerchief up to her face to conceal her smile. Time and time again, the handkerchief covered her face whenever she was spoken to. She began to worry that she was going to be found out to be a fraud by either the women of the boarding house or, worse, by the judge. Bly's concerns were short-lived. The constant handkerchief maneuvering caused the matron to believe Bly had a severe mental disorder. A few days after arriving at the boarding house, Bly was indeed deemed crazy. The matron of the house enlisted a few cops to escort her to the Essex Market Police Courtroom, where an impatient judge pronounced her insane and ordered her to the famed insane ward at Bellevue Hospital, the city's largest charitable hospital. A few days later, she boarded a ferry boat filled stern to stem with women deemed mentally ill by New York judges. The ambulance driver on the island would go on to tell her, "It's an insane place where you'll never get out of." Now that's reassuring, especially since she had no solid way of getting out of the asylum. When Bly arrived at Bellevue, an orderly attempted to forcibly remove her from the ambulance, but as she described it, "I resisted with the strength of an elephant." A nearby doctor instructed the orderly to stand down. The doctor then offered his hand to Bly, and she carefully exited the ambulance. At the intake center, a large man began asking Bly a series of questions. She refused to answer them. A nearby doctor told the intake officer that she was too insane to answer the questions anyway, and that he had already determined her mental illness. Screams and cries echoed the chamber. Bly began to feel very nervous, and it became apparent to the doctor, who quickly provided the explanation, that it was the carpenters that were making all this noise. Bly found herself near a young woman and asked her if she was insane. "I guess that's something you could have done back then." The woman replied, "No, but it's no use trying to convince anyone because the doctors and nurses won't listen." Bly continued talking to her and determined that she was indeed sane and didn't belong there. Bly moved on to two other patients and spoke with them. These two women were definitely insane. No sane person acted or spoke like these two. Bly began to feel assured that as long as she modeled her behavior after these two, no one would question her insanity. Bly quickly got into a very heated altercation with a nurse over her wearing a hat. The nurse demanded that Bly remove her hat, or she would, with male assistance, remove it with force. After back and forth yelling, Bly began to believe the nurse and promptly removed it. She was suddenly cold as all the windows were open, allowing the cold New York air in. Bly asked for a blanket but was refused. She could see that all the patients were freezing, but the nurses were bundled in coats and mittens. As Bly became increasingly agitated over the cold, a nurse arrived with a quilt and, shaking off the moths, handed it to her. There were more holes than quilt, Bly thought. Soon, a large man was standing in front of her. He greeted her with, "I've seen that face before," Bly replied with, "Then you know me." From there, she pretended to be from Cuba and spoke in broken English and broken Spanish. The doctor felt her pulse and pronounced sentence on her. "I consider it a hopeless case. She needs to be put where someone will take care of her." And like that, she was certified insane. Soon lunch was served. It was a gruel broth. Dinner was no better. It was a cup of tea and a small piece of bread. 6:15 was lights out. The bed was so hard that it didn't depress when she set her laid on it. It was as as hard as the steel frame that held it. Pillows were made of straw, and the blankets were so thin that even two of them couldn't keep her from shivering all night. She described the cold as iceberg cold. Sometime in the night, a doctor came to see her. Since the cold was preventing her from sleeping, she welcomed the thought of talking to someone. The visit was short-lived as the doctor simply pronounced her still insane, and then he left. Bly recalls that after the doctor left, the nurses purposely made noise all night long in order that the patients could not sleep. Bly pulled the covers over her head in a feeble attempt to get warm. No sooner had she covered her head did a nurse strip away the covers and insist that she get up since it was 6 a.m. She was offered only chicken broth for breakfast, although Bly said she would never have identified it as such. She was rushed into her room with another young doctor. The doctor began a barrage of questions regarding hearing voices and seeing faces in the walls. She answered his questions truthfully, but was once again diagnosed insane. Bly was soon escorted out of the room to a chair on the other side. Another patient was escorted in and asked the exact same questions. She heard the doctor exclaim, "You are hopelessly insane," and she watched as the young lady was escorted out. Bly thought, two questions are all it takes to determine one's sanity level, huh? Seems at least three questions would be in order for such a life-changing diagnosis. She began to smile at how ridiculous the questions were. Quickly, she threw her hands over her face to conceal her smile. The meals that followed that day were just as bad and lacking as the first day. Later that day, a new doctor examined her by asking her to stretch out her arms and wiggle her fingers. Bly did as the doctor instructed, and the doctor deemed that she was insane and a hopeless cause. Again, as night drew near, Bly could tell that this was going to be a repeat of the previous night. And she was right. Again, unbearably cold, very noisy, and constant interruptions by the staff. As morning approached, she was told to get up and get dressed. Bly found herself and others being loaded onto a boat. She quickly realized this was the boat headed to the madhouse. Bly and the other women were quickly ushered off the boat and onto a waiting carriage bound for the main insane asylum building. Oddly, Bly felt relief knowing that she had successfully fooled everyone into believing that she was insane. When they arrived at the asylum, one of Bly's companions was asked by a doctor if she knew why she was there. She only understood and spoke German. The doctor asked nurse with a German last name to translate for him. The nurse replied that she could not. The doctor grew frustrated and, without being able to defend herself, sentenced the young German woman to confinement for an undetermined amount of time. Bly was incensed. If you're going to confine people that don't speak English, then wouldn't it make sense to provide an interpreter? She thought. The German woman cried out in German as she was being taken away. One by one, Bly witnessed those that couldn't speak English being confined without ever being given a chance to defend themselves. Bly recorded several instances of doctors and nurses acting inappropriately in front of the patients in a manner that Bly referred to as being fresh with one another. One instance was while the doctor was determining her mental health. Again, Bly recorded that the doctor asked the nurse six personal questions to one medical question of me. Bly attempted to interrupt the flirting, but neither the doctor nor the nurse paid her any attention. In the end, the doctor ordered Bly to rejoin the other patients. Soon, a nurse took inventory of what Bly was wearing, then ordered her to go into the hall. She would soon find out why this inventory was taken. While standing in the hall, it was explained by another patient that this was how the nurses announced mealtime. Bly recalls waiting in a freezing hall for 15 minutes before being ushered into another freezing room. Finally, they reached the dining hall. In it was a single wooden table the length of the hall with wooden benches on either side. The nurses ordered all to sit in front of a meal setting. The meals consisted of water that they called tea, thinly sliced bread with butter, and five prunes. Bly recalls a fat woman rushing to the table and emptying three plates onto her plate. Those that now sat in front of empty plates were not served anything at all. It was feast or famine, strongest survive. Those that did eat had a hard time consuming the food. The bread was moldy, the butter was spoiled, and the prunes were insufficient. The nurses screamed for them to force the food down. Bly ate nothing that night. After dinner, the women were ordered into a cold, dank room and ordered to undress. Now she knew why they took inventory of her clothes. She was about to lose them. It was bath time. Bly refused to undress, but was persuaded when the nurses informed her that the men would be more than happy to remove her clothes by force. Bly verbally protested as the nurses began undressing her. without resistance. As the last article of clothing was removed, she jumped into the bath as to cover up her nakedness. The water was freezing. She found it hard to move, let alone bathe. The cold water shocked her into a motionless state. Through chattering teeth, she began to protest, but was ordered to shut up and bathe. Bly states, "As I couldn't move from the freezing water, a large, very insane woman began scrubbing me. I begged her not to touch my hair, but to no avail. I felt the woman was more drowning me than bathing me. Just as quickly as I jumped into the bath, I was yanked out and placed into a flannel slip, still soaking wet. Out of nowhere, a roar of insane laughter erupted from my mouth. Never had I felt so insane. I found herself in a room with 6 beds. A nurse announced that she was to sleep alone as she was noisy. The single room had the same hard bed as the intake center, the same thin blankets, but now Bly was soaking wet. To make things worse, the night nurse came into the room every half hour with a bright lantern and loud keys. Bly states, "Had I been able to sleep, I could not have." While lying in the water-soaked bed, freezing and unable to sleep, Bly began to think about the building catching on fire. Every door was locked. Every hall was locked. The main room to the halls and bedrooms were all locked. Should a fire break out, every patient would die. Even if the guards wanted to save the crazy people, they couldn't, Bly thought. The next day, Bly was forced to watch a procession of patients being paraded in front of her and the other women in the dorm. She asked who these people were, and a gray-haired, long-term patient answered, "These are the worst and most violent patients." Bly saw a group of women tied to each other by leather straps coming down the hall. One woman was sobbing, "You beat me and I shall not forget it. You want to kill me." Other ladies of that procession were black and blue from bruises and only looked at the floor, while others simply sobbed. The crippled, blind, and old were dragged across the ground by teams of nurses. Bly goes on to say that every day was the same. Sleep deprivation, starvation, little to no medical care for serious issues, and isolation. She surmised that it would only take a month or so before a sane person would actually go insane in these conditions. Many patients confided in Bly that they were praying for death. She witnessed beatings of patients for simply shivering. Bly witnessed a patient having a seizure and the nurse saying, "It serves her right," and did nothing to help her. Countless assaults and inappropriate touching was the call of the day for 10 days that Bly was confined to the madhouse. Bly states the following in regards to finally being released from Bellevue. "I had towards the last been shut off from all visitors, and so when the lawyer, Peter A. Hendricks, came and told me that friends of mine were willing to take charge of me if I would rather be with them than in the asylum, I was only too glad to give my consent. I asked him to send me something to eat immediately on his arrival in the city, and then I waited anxiously for my release. It came sooner than I had hoped. I was out in line taking a walk and had just gotten interested in a poor woman who had fainted away while the nurses were trying to compel her to walk. Goodbye, I'm going home," I called out to Pauline Mosier as she went past with a woman on either side of her. "Sadly, I said farewell to all that I knew and I passed them on my way to freedom and life while they were left behind to a fate worse than death. Adios," I murmured to the Mexican woman. I kissed my fingers to her, and so I left my companions of Hall 7. I'd looked forward to eagerly leaving this horrible place, yet when my release came and I knew that God's sunlight was going to be free for me again, there was a certain pain in leaving. For 10 days I'd been one of them. Foolishly enough, it seemed intensely selfish to leave them in their suffering. I felt a desire to help them by sympathy and presence. But only for a moment. The bars were down, and freedom was sweeter to me than ever. 2 days later, on Sunday, October 9th, 1887, the World ran the first installment of her story, titled Behind Asylum Bars, and Bly became an overnight sensation. The psychiatrists, who had erroneously diagnosed her as insane, offered profuse apologies, even as the remaining stories were widely syndicated across the nation. Not only did the New York City municipal government appropriate more money to the care of the mentally ill on Black Blackwell's Island, a grand jury was impaneled to investigate the abuses and poor treatment Bly had uncovered at the asylum. Approximately 1 month after her article ran in print, many of the most glaring problems she had reported had improved. Better living and sanitary conditions were instituted. More nourishing meals were provided. Translators were hired for the foreign-born, who were not necessarily mentally ill, but simply couldn't understand their keepers. And the most abusive nurses and physicians were fired, and some were charged with crimes. Bly sailed from one journalistic triumph to the next, including her whirlwind trip around the world in 72 days in 1889, a journey she primarily made while traveling by herself rather than with a chaperone. She sent a series of dispatches from the Eastern Front during World War I and reported on women's suffrage movements. In 1895, at the age of 31, she married the 73-year-old millionaire Robert Seaman, who ran the Ironclad Manufacturing Company, which made steel milk cans, stacking garbage cans, and boilers. Due to her husband's failing health, she retired from journalism and took over the reins of the company as president. Bly died of pneumonia at the age of 57 in 1922. One can only speculate what further triumphs and good deeds this remarkable woman might have achieved if she had only lived a few years longer. At the very least, she helped change the plight of the mentally ill in America. Sadly, that still requires attention to this day. So that's the story of the most fascinating woman to ever exist. If you can think of a more fascinating woman, leave it in the comments section. I would love to hear your thoughts. If you like this video, please give it a thumbs up and consider subscribing to 10 Minute History. If you have another 10 minutes, check out one of the videos that YouTube's going to recommend at the end. Until next time. Form Bly that should she ever step foot. That is not what that says, Michael. The matron of the house enlisted a few cops to escort her to the Essex Marketplace courtroom. Marketplace. Why do I keep saying marketplace? Market police. But what's a market police? The matron of the house enlisted a few cops to escort her to the Essex Market Police courtroom, where an impatient judge named Duffy pronounced her insane and ordered her to the famed Insane Award. Award? Award? Really, Mike? Award? Bly moved on to two other patients and spoke with them momentarily. That's not what that says.